scientists come from around the world to work at Sanford Underground Research Facility. During the month of October, we asked what you wanted to know about dark matter, building a detector, and working underground. And we had a few questions of our own. On Dark Matter Day, researchers with the LUX-ZEPLIN Dark Matter Experiment have the answers. How do you know that dark matter exists?
So, if you look at a spiral galaxy like our Milky Way, and you look at the outer stars of the Milky Way, so we all know this one moves around, and if you look at the further ones out, and if you look at the speed of those outer stars in a galaxy, then you realize that they should actually fly away because the matter in the galaxy is not enough to keep those outer stars in check. So you need to add more matter to the galaxy to actually be able to keep those outer stars in the spiral galaxy. Otherwise it would just kind of like dissolve itself. That's why we're thinking it's a dark matter particle that's all over. It's kind of like a halo around a galaxy, and it keeps those, it has this gravitational mass that keeps those outer stars in check.
What other experiments are looking for dark matter?
So there are many experiments looking for it, and in many different ways. So there are other direct detection experiments, like our experiment where we build an Earth-based detector and wait for dark matter particles to interact with our detector. But then there are also colliders, like the Large Hadron Collider, which think that they can maybe produce dark matter particles and detect them in this way. And the third way is astronomers and cosmologists looking at the sky and seeing, because we know dark matter is out there, seeing whether it interacts in some sort of way out there and whether we see an excess of certain types of events. So there are really many different ways of looking for dark matter, and it's really important that we look in every possible way, because we might get some information and they get a different kind of information, and we can compare and complement the picture.
What new science and applications could arise from dark matter studies?
There are technologies that we use in building a dark matter detector that have applications elsewhere. So things like the cryogenic systems that we use, that's kind of used also in medical physics, those kind of fields. And of course, the advancements that we make in things like computing and analysis and software, all of those things have some applications in other areas of science and in wider industries. So while not directly coming from the science that we do, those are some knock-on effects that might have some applications in other fields and industries.
What is the hardest part of designing a dark matter detector?
The most special thing is that we need materials that have very low radioactivity. And so the radioactivity creates a background for the experiment that makes it harder to see dark matter. So to give you some kind of understanding, your body produces about 4,000 radioactive events in a second. And the materials that we're looking for are going to be many orders of magnitude less than that. So our 2,000 kilogram cryostat, we'd like to produce less than one neutron in 5 years.
The hardest part about designing a detector or anything really is actually making it so you can put it together. You can design everything you want, but you know, you have to actually be able to bring it in through the door into your water tank or your lab or anything else. So if you can't actually put it together, it doesn't really matter how good it is, because you won't be able to use it.
Why did the detector have to be built in a clean room?
So the signals we're looking for are very, very rare, and all around us we have radioactivity in dust, for example. So we have to make sure, for one, to build the detector out of materials which are non-radioactive, and to also not have any dust in the detector, because dust, it has radioactivity in it. So being in a clean room means that you can control your dust levels, that you can make sure that the detector stays as clean as possible.
What is the most challenging thing about working in a clean room?
So first of all, you wear all this gear, like you wear the mouth guard, and you sometimes have to wear glasses as well, and you have a covered from head to toe, so you first have to get comfortable with working in that. And then we're used to touching things. not everything in a clean room is equally clean. So you have to make sure you only, if you touch something a little dirtier, not to touch the clean things afterwards, to change your gloves all the time. So to become aware of that, that's really, I think, the thing to get really used to at the beginning.
I'd definitely rather work underground because you can at least have your coffee out there in the Davis campus. Coffee's frowned upon when you're in a clean suit, so.
What does WIMP stand for?
So it needs to be a massive particle, and then we know it doesn't really interact with other matter or with itself, so it needs to be weakly interacting. And now you just create this generic name called weakly interactive massive particle. That's a WIMP.
Does the weakly in WIMP mean the proposed particle interacts rarely with other matter, or that it interacts via the weak force?
So since we don't know exactly how it interacts with normal matter, we know how it should react gravitationally, because this is how we sort of propose it, but we haven't really detected it and don't know exactly how it interacts with normal matter. It needs to be acting weakly. Weakly meaning it needs to act as rarely as the neutrino interacts, which is on the weak scale. So that's why it's weakly interacting.
Can the latest discoveries related to gravitational waves tell us anything about dark matter?
So the fields are quite different, although they both kind of involve gravity. One way in which gravitational waves can help us say something about dark matter is kind of specific to certain dark matter candidates. So one of those is primordial black holes, which are black holes that were thought to be produced in the early universe. And gravitational waves are a very nice way to probe the interaction of large cosmic bodies colliding with each other, and they produce these ripples in space-time, which we call gravitational waves. So if primordial black holes do make up some component of dark matter, then gravitational waves would be a way in which we could study that.
What is the best thing about working in Leeds, South Dakota?
Well, I think, you know, I could say the weather, but that would be a lie. I think that the people here are really good. They're, it's a very friendly place. You walk into a store or a restaurant and people are generally interested in what you're doing. When people ask you, how are you, they expect an answer.
The people. It's a really great community, and everyone I've met really likes the lab out there and what we're doing, and everyone's just really enthusiastic. It's great.
It's really nice to be able to enjoy like the local area with, you know, essentially your friends and your colleagues. We like all of the kind of local businesses that are around, so, you know, if it's getting like coffee at Lotus Up or going for food at Sled House, singing karaoke at the Greenfields on a Friday night, it's really nice to kind of be in that space and share it with local people too that we meet.